States Navy Union the 2014 leadership selection. With all the excitement and suspense of the anniversary, it's exactly what they're on. And it's class 2014, which is the first ships in the career. Ships will be very, very modular in how they deliver their capabilities, and it's a pretty exciting future for us.
Yes, sir. With three crews on HLCS, what do you think the prospects are for COs that matter for making CO better?
Littoral Combat Ship is our newest class ship. We just finished the deployment of the first one, the USS Freedom, to Singapore. And what's different about this ship is they're designed to stay forward for 18 months, so we have three crews with three captains for every two hulls, and one of them's always forward. So these ships are large ships, but they're minimally manned. But yeah, so to answer your question directly, having 78 crews will increase the number of command opportunities for our surface warfare officers out in the future.
Which is fantastic, especially for upwards of, I believe, 250 midshipmen we have become exposed tonight, so that's incredible. At this year's SNA, we heard about a program that is called, well, it's similar to the Bears Top Gun. So we have a new SWO Top Gun. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Yeah, people call it the SWO Top Gun because it's the easiest way to describe it. But it's an attempt by the Surface Warfare Command to develop a command whose primary duty is to develop tactics, train tactics, assess tactics, and make sure that they're commonly distributed and trained to across the U.S. fleet, much like Top Gun does for air warfare. The Aviation Command has been very successful, and I think we need to model that for the Surface Warfare Command, so we're going to do it starting this next summer.
So it's coming up soon.
It is.
Fantastic. And what's your best advice you have for these SWOs tonight?
I think the best advice I'd give any new officer or a veteran officer that walks aboard a ship is that they have to, they walk on board with a certain amount of respect that's garnered upon them. In fact, they're a commissioned officer in the United States Navy, and they've got to work hard to build upon that respect by increasing their professional knowledge and treating their peers and their subordinates and the folks that we've asked them to lead with respect and demanding the same in their life. I think if you do that, a lot of people follow.
Well, thank you so much, Admiral, for joining us. We're going to take it out to Petty Officer Timberlake. Timberlake, are these midshipmen ready to get the show started? Well, Petty Officer Wells, I know I'm ready to get the show started, but judging by the energy in Mahan Auditorium tonight, I'm pretty sure these midshipmen have been waiting quite a long time for this. Tonight's the night. We've got 243 mates getting ready to pick their ships for their first Surface Warrior assignments. It's a big night. It's really important for a lot of people, and it's very exciting to see the future of the Navy. So pretty soon we're going to get started. As soon as the ceremony starts, we will see where these midshipmen are going with their futures.
Let's get this party started. All right, well, good evening. Admiral Miller, flag officers, distinguished guests, Naval Academy staff, friends and family, classmates, midshipmates, members of the brigade, midshipmen, and most importantly, Surface Warfare Officer Selectees of the Grand Class of 1991. is 23. They really demand the public. I'm Ed Gadd, the director of professional development and welcome to Ship Selection Night 2014. I've got a great night ahead of us, and I know you're all looking forward to getting off the program, so I'll get right to business and introduce our guest speaker, Vice Admiral Tom Copeland, Commander of Naval Surface Forces. Admiral Copeland has had a very distinguished career. At sea, his commands included USS Bedford, UDG 65, and Destroyer Squadron 28, where he deployed as Sea Combat Commander with George Washington Carrier Striker to the Arabian Gulf in support of operations in Iraqi and enduring freedom. Ashore, he served in a variety of key staff positions, including Director, Navy Senate Liaison in the Office of Legislative Affairs, Chief of Staff for Naval Surface Forces, Deputy Chief of Staff for Operations and Training for U.S. Pacific Fleet, Commander Joint Task Force Guantanamo Bay, Cuba, and most recently, Chief of Legislative Affairs. He's here tonight to help us celebrate this unique Naval Academy event and to lead us in bearing witness to this important personal and professional milestone in the lives of our newest crop of future surface warfare junior officers. So thank you very much for taking time out of your busy schedule. Ladies and gentlemen, Vice Admiral Copeland. Sorry about getting started here, and I will keep my remarks down about 55 minutes. I've rehearsed it a number of times, and I promise it won't be any longer than that, unless we get into sea storms. And we'll take questions afterwards, and eventually we'll get to this. No? You know what I mean? Okay, fine. Give the wave off. For my last one down here. Thanks for the kind introduction. This is my second time I've been here. I didn't make it last year because of sequestration and travel restrictions. I was here the year before, which was the first time I've been here. It was pretty interesting and very, very much different than my experience at the officer candidate school in 1982 when the senior chief barked at us to go back grab the name of a ship on a popsicle stick and hand it to the Hawaiian one and get back to work. This is a much, much better way of doing this. I think it's pretty exciting because, you know, as we discussed at the table, and I think all the old sea dogs in here will be able to affirm, as the night wears on, your first ship is going to be very, very special to you. You're going to remember it for the rest of your life, and I don't care whether it's a good experience or a bad experience. It's mostly going to be good memories. I'll tell you that. My best friends in the Navy, lifelong friends, are all from my first ship. USS Love, which I'm the only one left still hanging around on active duty, but we get together, and it's a brotherhood that I think will never be broken. So I got to tell you, it makes it pretty exciting to get there and see these. Ships up there. You're going to remember it forever. You're going to remember the bonds that you make. I decided very early on to be a surface warfare officer. It's kind of our family business. My grandfather was a SWO, my dad was a SWO, and I'm a SWO. And so it's always been very enticing to me to go to sea. And I'll tell you, there's nothing better to me. And I still have trade places with you right now, except for the Grand Rivers. to go back to sea again and give up my much more down. Job that I have right now. You're going to be very, very lucky. Today, the United States Navy, the surface Navy in particular, is existential to the United States Navy. We have been since the very first day this Republic was founded. There's a lot of navies out there in the world. There's a few of them that have aircraft carriers and a few of them that have submarines, but there's none of them that are out there that calls itself a Navy that don't have surface ships that will remain existential to the United States Navy, no matter what happens to the rest of the fleet or the rest of the budget. So we do a very, very important job keeping the sea lines of communication open across the world, patrolling the ocean seas, and we're out there when we need to be here. And so it's a very, very important. It's very difficult to get trained up and be good at our profession. And you'll be faced with a lot of hard work in the next couple of years. And what's unique about surface warfare, I think, for most of you sitting here, in a little less than probably 3 or 4 months after you graduate, you're going to be standing on the deck of a ship, talking to a group of people that you're charged with leading, while the rest of your compatriots are probably TUI and sitting and waiting to get flight school started or go to nuclear power school. And by the time you're able to get into the first ship, you'll probably have 1 or 2 deployments on your belt and a bunch of really, really good experiences in leadership. So it's really something to look forward to. I've enjoyed every single minute of it. I've been doing this for 32 years, and it's been fantastic, and I really do wish I could trade places with you. Your responsibilities as ensigns and JGs, I think, will exceed anything that your peers in the civilian community have gone to, even the highest powered Ivy League schools and business schools will experience for a long, long time to come for them. You're going to be pressed immediately into the role of being leaders with men and women that you might have to
short runs notice on the planet, land in a battle or land into a space that might have been damaged. So it's very, very unique, I think, for a group of people of your age and exposed to get out there very, very quickly. There's a couple of other talked just very quickly. There's a couple of LCSs up there. A couple of people asked me about it. We have four engines on it. You'll have two other people on the bridge on watch with you, and one other person on the entire ship on watch with you. So if you weren't thinking about an LCS, you might want to think, because you're not doing orders, you're doing it, you're just driving a ship with a joystick. It's kind of a cool ship. It turned out it's not the Freedom, just completed its first 10-month deployment. The Coronado just sailed away this week, and that's the fourth one, and we're stuck going for a year. So if you haven't thought about that in the past, I mean, there's two of them up there, and I'm convinced, I think somebody was able to maybe think about it, but we'll see. I got his last chair for me. He's pretty high up, so thank goodness. Anyone's listening, let me know. So, finally, there's a lot of issues that we face. You can't open up a newspaper and talk about the budget pressures that we face in the United States Navy. But I think at the end of the day, the surface Navy is a very, very good bargain for the American taxpayer. We make up 73% of the commissioned ships in the United States Navy. We are the preponderance of the deployed forces around the world, and we consume a grand total of 11% in the United States Department of the Navy's budget. So we're a heck of a good deal. We provide a lot of combat punch. We provide a lot of options for the president and the command authorities out there. And I'll stop talking now because I know you guys want to get up there and start talking about this. This is it. Any questions in the back? Okay.
Now we have the number one order merit amongst selectees, Midshipman Bryn Bach. USS Simpson. Next to pick, Midshipman Justin Chuck. Midshipman Chop selects USS Jersey. Next up, Midshipman Audrey Petrie. Midshipman Petrie selects USS Donald Cook. Next pick, Midshipman Jillian Coughlin. Midshipman Coughlin selects USS Donald Cook out of Rota, Spain. Next, Midshipman Michael Madrid. Midshipman Madrid selects USS Austin, enemy coast of Japan. Up next, Midshipman Brian Fritz. Midshipman Fritz selects USS Donald Cook out of Rota, Spain. Next to select, Midshipman Samuel Dodson. Midshipman Dodson selects MC Corlear out of Edmond, Bahrain. Next up.
All right, I'm here with Midshipman Bryn Bach, who is the first to choose her ship. How are you feeling tonight?
Excited. A little overwhelming, but really excited.
And what ship did you pick?
I picked the Samson at DDG.
answer to us about why you picked that one?
It was a hard process, a lot of great ports to choose from. I decided on San Diego because of watching my fiance is a DOD officer, and so we were trying to find the best way to coordinate our schedules. And I absolutely love California and just the warm climate. And then I had an awesome experience on the Chengdu this past summer, so which is a destroyer based out of Pearl Harbor, so I was set on a destroyer.
Okay. And how does your family feel about it? Are they excited?
They're excited. I know they're watching right now. So this is a big night for all of us.
Okay, well, congratulations. Take care.
Thank you.
Carol Fisher. Jimmy Fisher is quite serious as Fitzgerald living across the Japan. Next up, midshipman Polly Gilson. Midshipman Gilson selects USS Essex out of San Diego. Next to pick, midshipman Lindsay Darling. Midshipman Darling selects USS Iwo Jima out of Newport, Florida. Up next, midshipman Patrick McAllister. Midshipman McAllister selects USS William P. Lawrence out of San Diego, California. Next to select, midshipman Gerald River. Midshipman River selects USS Michael Murphy out of Pearl Harbor, Hawaii. Next up, midshipman Caleb Trabowski. Midshipman Trabowski selects USS Chaffee out of Pearl Harbor. Up next, midshipman Eric Fortner. Midshipman Porter selects USS Donald Cook out of Rota, Spain. Next to pick, midshipman Brett Mason. Midshipman Mason selects USS Curtis Lover out of Yokosuka, Japan.
Expected to take care of them, to lead them, to
families are taking care of those kind of challenges or wouldn't make them any. We call it an Annie family, don't we? That's absolutely true. And so if we've done our jobs here, when they leave the Naval Academy, they will find that they've got a family on a ship and it will be as important to them as the families that they had back home.
Speaking on that, what is it about the Naval Academy that prepares them for those challenges?
Now we've got a pretty rigorous four-year program here. But I think morally, mentally, and physically, our students are immersed in this for 4 years, some for five. And in that process, they kind of come to know themselves. And I think anybody that you talk to, whether it's your parents or their friends, will say, you know, they went in, like all of us, were just kids. And you grow so much in the Naval Academy because it gives you the opportunity not just to learn how to succeed, but it gives you a chance to fail and to learn from your mistakes. And to get back up, dust yourself off, and figure out how we're going to defend America for the future. Because there are no points for second place in the business that they're going to go into.
Very true. And this is something we asked Admiral Cookman as well. What advice do you have for these midshipmen tonight?
I think you take every day as a gift. You should be. We are so proud of that, because I know everybody who's listening are so very proud of that. But you take every day as a gift with the expectation that the best is going to happen. And I'll tell you what, if you're going life that way, in our Navy today, there's every reason to expect that there's going to be a great sunrise and another great sunset.
There's nothing like the sunrise at sea.
Yes, and or sunset. It doesn't matter. It's all good.
Okay, well, thank you so much for spending some time with us tonight. Now, let's go over to Petty Officer Timberlake. Thank you, Petty Officer Wells. Let's take a look at what Admiral Rowden, the Director of Surface Warfare, has to say about ship selection night.
We do safety. That's what we do in surface warfare. And the men and women that are going to be graduating from the Naval Academy this year, they're going to be selecting their ships. They're going to be part of a huge part of what it is we do for the men and women that walk down the streets every day that never even realize what it is we do. But we control the sea. And our Navy controls the sea, and surface warfare's contribution is front and center.
Now, Midshipman Joshua Hildebrand. Midshipman Hildebrand selects USS Nolan Gold out of Norfolk, Virginia. Next to select Midshipman Audrey Bauer. Someone is going to be the first. Next to pick, Midshipman Alexander Vaughn. Midshipman Vaughn selects USS Roosevelt out of Newport, Florida. Up now, Midshipman Juliana Everest.
I'm here with Rear Admiral Gumatata, who is Commander Naval Surface Force Atlantic. Thank you so much for joining us tonight.
Oh, you're very welcome, NC One Plus.
And what advice do you have for these future surface warfare officers as they begin their journey into the fleet tonight?
Well, first of all, I want them to celebrate this moment, because they've worked so hard to get to this place, and then, more importantly, they had a very tough decision on what community they wanted to serve. And choosing surface warfare is an awesome decision. And they're going to learn so much about leadership from the first day they step on board. So my advice to them would be to do the same type of rigor that they did to get them through the academy. Work hard, do the right thing, listen to your chief petty officer. And most importantly, I think in the Naval Academy, they built leaders, and leaders lead teams. Build a team in whatever division you're assigned to, and then just go out and have fun.
Very sound advice.
Well, thank you.
You've gone.
selection night was a little bit more solo, actually. Tonight's more of a celebration. And I waited to the last second to come out here to get this interview because just the atmosphere in Ohio Hall is just electrifying. People, I know there are some folks that are not first class, probably second class youngsters. They're all up there in the rafters cheering their fellow midshipmen on. And then I think a lot of the midshipmen here have actually done a lot of homework. They can see that they go right to a location or right to a ship. And it wasn't that good for us. We didn't have all the flag officers and senior squads that are here tonight. I think our community has really grown in that perspective, that there's a lot more of the awareness of how important tonight is for the future of the surface warfare. So it's not even close at all to what I had. And it's all for the good, though.
Yes. Did you get the ship that you wanted?
Actually, I picked the location. I picked Hawaii. And then, funny thing happened along the way, I security, they said I was diverted to another ship in San Diego, but it was still great. And it was just so happened to be the same place that I met my wife. We've been married for 29 years, so you know what? I love that detail. It was perfect.
Same before
got
married.
It worked out fine.
What are some of the challenges? What are some of the opportunities that these folks are going to be seeing in their future?
I think the biggest challenge for them is to get their team, whatever division they have, to focus into a greater good. And not as an individual, but to get everyone to understand why they're doing something and not just work. Because work is work. But if you work for a purpose, I think that's one of the things that they have to pick up real quick. That nobody's going to turn around and tell them how to do it. But their CO is going to expect them to do it. And the CO is going to expect them to be the best division in that ship. So what I would think as a challenge would be is to make sure they articulate to their people that every one of them is special and that that entire division is doing something extremely important in the mission of the ship. I think that's the biggest challenge. And as far as just what they will find out going on their ship, it's a little bit different than the yard. I think the yard is fairly truncated as to what they have to do, where they have to go, you know, being in a place at a certain time. When they go to the waterfront, they actually lay that out. They lay that out for the team, and they just essentially have to sync up with the rest of the crew. And that's going to be an interesting transformation, but they'll do fine. The reason why they'll do fine is because they have what it takes to succeed. And I think it's up to our community to get them all excited. It is up to them to learn as much about a surface warfare community because essentially they're going to have a watch here in the future. Guys like me and Admiral Copeman, well, we're going to retire sooner than later. And it's going to be these young ensigns that are going to be commanding ships one day that perhaps can do greater things other than just command, but stay in the Navy and do something worthwhile throughout their whole career. So there's a lot more things to look forward to than they actually worry about challenges.
Thank you so much for spending some time with us.
You're very welcome.
I would like to get back inside.
That's a celebration.
Yes, it sounds. A lot is going on in there, so why don't we go ahead and go back inside as well?
Thank you.
Sure. Chief in mind, Spender, Select USS Mason, out of Norfolk, Virginia. Next up, Midshipman Emily Hughes. Midshipman Hughes, Select USS Spender, out of the Postman Japan. Next to pick, Midshipman Trenton Lane. Midshipman Lane selects USS Jonas with a United Coast of Japan. Next up, Midshipman.
I am here with Commander Tom Dickinson from USS Erie. Sir, how do you feel about being here tonight?
Tonight's a great Saturday. Last time I was here in 1995 when I picked my first ship, and you can see the excitement on the faces of the midshipmen here. Same things I feel about most of 23 years of starting a career.
Okay. And what are you looking forward to most about having these new officers on board your ship?
Well, I'm excited to greet them and to explain to them what my ship is about and what they can have to look forward to. Right now, the service name is busier than we've ever been. We just completed a 9-month deployment in the Mediterranean, and we're scheduled to be in Japan. So exciting to tell them what's in their future, which is it's very exciting in and of itself.
So do you have any advice for these new swells?
My advice to swells is come motivated. Get ready to meet people. We're going to put you in charge right away. That's a good answer for standing here later from day one. And stand by for an awesome experience. Come with energy.
All right. Thank you so much, sir. Back to you, MC1.
Next up, midshipman Logan Wilk. Midshipman Wilk, Sparks, knows this Jack Ball Jones out of Pearl Harbor. Up now, midshipman Jose Iglesias. Iglesias likes to assist Farragut out of Midport, Florida. Up now, midshipman John Founds. Midshipman Founds likes to assist Brandon Meyer out of San Diego, California. Up now, midshipman James Thomas. Jimmy Thomas selects USS Vicksburg out of Midport, Florida.
With me, I have Captain Welch, who is representing the Surface Warfare Community Night, LCS.
Yes.
And what does this night mean to you, sir?
Well, it's an exciting time for Surface Warfare to realize that there's 243 midship, and this is the future, the next generation of leadership in our surface community. And to realize that they're taking, this represents their next step in their professional development. And in a matter of months, every single man and woman walking across that stage is going to be able to board a ship leading the sailors of our great Navy. That's pretty exciting to think about. And it's also exciting to see older people like me come back. And so it's the past, it's us coming together in the present, and we can also see into the future of where our community is going.
What was this night like for you?
It was a little bit different. There weren't many microphones. There weren't any cameras. Nobody did those kind of interviews. The process itself was pretty similar. Once we selected for surface warfare, we kind of did it all one night. So you went through one big line, and then you got on the surface warfare line. And then we went into one of the Falls Memorial Hall, and we had the same big board, and you walked up and picked your first ship, which is it's a pretty exciting moment in the life for a young small community.
What made you choose this whole community?
I grew up in Peoria, Illinois, world's most average city in the middle of the country. And so as I began to think about and investigate joining the Navy, the first pictures that I saw and the first things I thought about were ships, destroyers. And so throughout my time here at the Naval Academy, I kept coming back to that. It's what I know. When I pictured the Navy as a young teen, and it's what I keep coming back to. And the opportunity to drive ships was always exciting to me. The chance to lead people early on was something that really appealed.
What do these midshipmen have to look forward to as soon as they pretty much exit this building and report to their ship?
Well, they've been here learning leadership. They get a chance to apply what they've learned the moment they step on board their first ship. So they're almost immediate. Within a week or so, they're standing in front of the division at work center, and they're leading sailors. And that's a big responsibility. They also get the chance to learn on board the most technologically advanced ships in the world. And so, one of the other great benefits to Navy SWO, and it starts on day one and it continues, in my case, for 27 years, is the chance to learn something new every day. And that's a great opportunity.
What advice do you have for them today?
I told them what I just said. Always have an insatiable sense of professional curiosity. Every time you step aboard the ship, every time you get a chance to stand in front of sailors and learn something, those sailors are great technicians and leaders in their own right. They can teach these young officers and help them develop and grow. And the other thing I would say is just remember on this night and remember this place that they came from. They have taken it off, and they have accepted a commission, and from day one they are officers in the United States Navy. It's a tremendous responsibility. It's a tremendous privilege and pleasure.
Thank you so much for spending some time with us tonight, sir.
Thank you very much.
All right, we're going to go over to Petty Officer Timberlake now. I'm here with Midshipman First Class Madrid and Wilk. What did, first of all, what ships did you guys pick?
What is Madrid? USS Weston, destroyer at Yokosuka, Japan.
That is the USS John Paul Jones, which is now being homeported in Pearl Harbor, Hawaii. All right. What did you pick, ship?
I was able to spend my summer in Japan. I really fell in love with the country and I'm excited to go out and learn how the action will be with the Foreign Deployed Forces.
Has the newest combat system, and I'm really excited to test it out and try new things. Okay, and what are you guys looking forward to most about being SWOs and getting out there in the fleet?
I'm looking forward to having people who need paid sailors, newest sailors, and look forward to traveling a lot and hopefully making life more calls all over the Pacific.
I'm looking forward to making a difference in the lives of the people I'm leading, and also just in general, the American lives. Okay, thank you so much, guys, for being with us, and we're going to go back inside.
Ship and Shelf Selects, USS Alvarez, Pearl Harbor, Hawaii. Up now, Midshipman Benjamin Walters. Midshipman Walters selects USS Gilead, set of San Diego, California. Next to select Midshipman Madeline McFarland. Midshipman McFarland selects USS Shoup. Everett, Washington. Next to select, Midshipman Garland Christopher. Midshipman Christopher selects USS Spruance out of San Diego, California. Next to Nick, Midshipman Alyssa Kim. Midshipman Kim selects USS New Orleans out of San Diego, California. Currently selected Midshipman Alexa Rizzo. Midshipman Rizzo selects USS Boxer out of San Diego. Next up, Midshipman Gabriella Scherer. Midshipman Scherer selects USS Ridley out of San Diego, California. Next to pick, Midshipman Gabriela Torres. Midshipman Torres selects USS Bainbridge out of Norfolk, Virginia. Next up, Midshipman Ryan Dallas. Selects USS Shiloh out of Yokosuka, Japan. Next to pick, Midshipman Neil McMillan. Midshipman McMillan picks USS Stockdale out of San Diego, California. Next up, Midshipman Kelsey Shabak. Midshipman Shabak selects USS Lady Gulf out of Norfolk, Virginia. Next up, Midshipman Eric Houghton. Midshipman Matt selects USS Dewey out of San Diego, California. Next to pick, Midshipman Alan Mann.
flights to USS Blue Ridge and the Yokosuka, Japan.
Next to select, Midshipman Kelly Mullen.
Midshipman Miles selects USS Shiloh and the Yokosuka, Japan.
Next up, Midshipman Alexandra Lynch.
Midshipman Lynch selects USS New Orleans and San Diego, California.
Up here, Midshipman Cheyenne Whitman.
Midshipman Wendell selects USS Germantown and Sasebo, Japan.
Next to pick, Midshipman Ryan Rapata.
Midshipman Rapata selects USS Kidd out of San Diego, California.
Next up, Midshipman Nicholas Galanos.
Midshipman Galanos selects USS Boxer out of San Diego, California.
Up now, Midshipman Grace Dalton.
Midshipman Dalton selects USS Carl Vinson out of San Diego, California.
Next up, Midshipman Nicholas Dubé.
Midshipman Dubé selects USS Clayton out of San Diego, California.
Next up, Midshipman Marissa Leon.
Midshipman Leon selects USS Simpson out of Newport, Florida.
Up next, Midshipman Weston Kennedy.
Midshipman Kennedy selects USS San Diego out of San Diego, California.
Up now, Midshipman Elizabeth Rubin.
Midshipman Rubin selects USS New Orleans out of San Diego, California.
Up next, Midshipman Sean Murphy.
Midshipman Murphy selects USS Laboon out of Norfolk, Virginia.
Next to select, Midshipman Ivan Cipriani.
Midshipman Cipriani selects USS Carter Hill out of Norfolk, Virginia.
Up next, Midshipman Bryce Boyer.
Midshipman Boyer selects USS Galpins.
Out of San Diego, California.
Was it Pearl Harbor?
Anyway. Next up, Midshipman Amanda Parsons.
Midshipman Parsons selects USS Ingraham out of Everett, Washington.
Up next, Midshipman Daphne White.
Midshipman White selects USS Decatur out of San Diego, California.
With a couple of midshipmen who just selected their ships, could you please introduce yourselves?
I'm Faye Ann Wingate, 17th Company, and I chose the USS Germantown in Sasebo, Japan.
Hi, I'm Jill Thompson, 29th Company, and I chose the USS Donald Cook out of Rhode Island.
Okay. What made you pick the Germantown?
attention. I was torn. I picked Rota because I've always wanted to go abroad. I went on a four-deploy cruise this summer, and I loved it, so I thought this would be a great opportunity to continue that trend. What I like most about it was the second question.
What made you choose that platform?
I'm looking forward to a smaller community, a smaller first command, just get to know the ropes better, and work my way up from there.
Okay. What are you most excited about going out to the fleet, getting to your first ships?
I think just the challenge of meeting new people and really having people that work hard for you and you work hard for them.
What about you?
I think on the same thing, it's rather daunting when you're looking at it, especially coming straight from here. It's definitely going to be a total life change, and I think we're ready for it. I think we'll do well.
Okay. Thank you guys so much for joining us. We're going to take it back to the auditorium to see the rest of this ship selection.
Midshipman Rubino selects USS New Orleans out of San Diego, California. Up now, Midshipman Taylor Sinus. Midshipman Sinus selects USS Russell out of San Diego, California. Up now, Midshipman Matthew Wolford. Midshipman Wolford selects USS Mitchell out of Norfolk, Virginia. Next to select Midshipman Patrick Taylor. Midshipman Taylor selects USS San Antonio out of Norfolk, Virginia. Now Midshipman Paul Winston. Midshipman Winston selects USS Rodney Davis out of Everett, Washington. Up now, Midshipman Barclay Walter. Midshipman Walter selects USS Graydon LCS Crew 101. Up now, Midshipman Michaela Knox. Selects USS Carl Vinson out of San Diego, California.
I'm here with Vice Admiral Michelle Howard. Thank you so much for joining us tonight, Ben.
Absolutely.
What do you think about tonight so far?
Oh, it's inspirational, the enthusiasm, and just the joy of watching these midshipmen pick their ships and pick their future.
And what was your ship selection like?
Well, for one thing, it was very different. Ships had just opened up to women while I was at Annapolis, so there were only 7 ships available for women. And then everybody else was either going to be Supply Corps or Intelligence, so I got the 7th of 7 ship slots. So it was very exciting for me.
So was that the ship that you wanted?
I just wanted to get to sea, so compared to the opportunities that men had at the time, it was just elusive. It felt like, so it was wonderful to get that ship.
What do these folks need to do in order to succeed in the fleet?
Well, they have all the skill sets they need. They got them here. They're just going to have to practice leadership and management. They're going to be terrific.
And a lot of these midshipmen are going to Hawaii and Japan. So what do they need to know about our rebalancing and our refocus to the Pacific when they get out there?
Whether they're engaged in Hawaii, in Japan, or in Rota, Spain, our ships are globally distributed and globally deployed. So it's making yourself at your warfighting ready. Your home port is where your ship's based out of, and you've got to be ready to go anywhere at a moment's notice.
What advice would you have for them today?
Have fun. It's a wonderful life. It's a wonderful career they've chosen. And they're going to be terrific leaders. They just need to have fun.
And is there anything else you would like to add?
No.
Thank you so much for giving us some of your time, and I'll let you get back inside today.
All right. Thank you.
have been running wild.
Midshipman Wyatt selects USS Lincoln Island out of San Diego, California. Next up, Midshipman Matthew Lee Hollinger. Midshipman Lee Hollinger selects USS Kearsarge out of Norfolk, Virginia. Up next, Midshipman Jack Dombrowski. USS Fort McHenry out of Bentport, Florida. Midshipman Brandon Clark. Midshipman Brandon Clark selects USS Bainbridge. Brian Roby, you're on deck. Midshipman Matthew Bernucci. Yes, Midshipman Bernucci, good. Midshipman Barry Justin. So Justin says USS Independence out of San Francisco, San Diego. Midshipman William Banks. Midshipman Harris, USS Austin, out of Houston. Midshipman Matthew Jackson. USS Normandy, out of Norfolk, Virginia. Midshipman Tanner Murphy. Midshipman Murphy selects USS Hopper out of Pearl Harbor. Midshipman Shannon Levy. Midshipman Levy selects USS Fort McHenry out of Bentport, Florida. Midshipman Thomas Craft. Midshipman Craft, USS Freedom out of San Diego, California. Midshipman Benjamin Smith. Midshipman Smith, USS Preston out of San Diego. Midshipman Stephen O'Dell. Midshipman O'Dell, USS Wilson, out of Bentport, Florida. Good job. Midshipman Michael Nugent. Midshipman Nugent, USS Lake Erie, Pearl Harbor, Florida. Robert Yerkes, Virginia. Midshipman Bias, USS George Washington, Yokosuka, Japan. Yokosuka.
Pacific Carrier Flags. USS Grand San Diego. Missionary Sis Figueroa. Missionary Figueroa and USS Wilson out of the coast of Japan.
Another successful year, another successful show, our second one. What did you think, Timberlake? Surface warriors with all the new technology, LCS, DDG-1000, the new ballistic missile defense stuff. Like, the future is very, very bright for the Navy and for these midshipmen. So, if you had to put LCS up against DDG-1000 in the Super Bowl, what would your pick be? Well, I've never been on board DDG-1000, so I'm going to have to go with LCS. They're amazing, they're flexible, they do like everything, different mission packages, like LCS, it's pretty much the be all end all. So that's our next standing station, right? Well, they work really hard. What about the Super Bowl? Who are you picking tomorrow? Oh, I gotta go with my Seattle Seahawks. I was at a station in Bremerton. I did some time up there, so I feel like I'm really, truly a Seahawk at heart. We'll see tomorrow, Super Bowl. Well, please continue to watch the rest of the ceremony on Navy.mil. From all of us at the Defense Media Activity, thank you so much for watching, and continue watching from the Mayhem Auditorium. Have a good night.
So let's go, Sessions, to the Navy at the Roads. I should have taken those. This is Port Royal, Port Harbor 1. The ship in the Red Sea Harbor. The ship in the Red Sea Harbor. This is Port Royal, Norfolk, Virginia. The ship in Hudson, Gaskins. We got the slicers of Lake Area, Pearl Harbor 1. Ship of Karina Schmidt. USS Antigua, Mayport, Florida. Ship of Scott Snowden. This is Fort Worth, San Diego. Ship of David Norman. This is Fort Worth, Pearl Harbor, Hawaii. The ship of Chelsea Smith. USS Roosevelt, out of Mayport, Florida. The ship of Crystal Cannon. USS Lexington Lang. The ship of Boston Arena. Oh, Eric Lyons, see the one. I should have known it's like this, that's actually. I should have been looking at this box building. so we go home.
Thanks, bud.
So Max Bailey was as good as we are before Florida. Midshipman Jonathan Webb. Mr. West likes USS Baton of Norfolk, Virginia. Midshipman Catherine Webb. Mr. Horse likes USS Gravely, Norfolk, Virginia. Midshipman Trina Gabowski. Mr. Horse likes USS Preston, Ann Arbor. Midshipman Beatrice Kaybog. Mr. Kaybog likes USS Ashland, Midshipman Roberto Garcia. Midshipman Garcia selects us as Explorer in Freeport, Florida. Midshipman Michael Citro. Mr. Johnson is USS Port Royal. Mr. Shepard Cassidy is Simmons. Mr. Shepard Simmons is USS Iceland, your close to Japan. Mr. Shepard Andrew Billy. Mr. Shepard Billy USS Chancellorsville. Midshipman Samir Sheikh. Midshipman Sheikh selects USS Bahia out of Norfolk, Virginia. Midshipman Spencer Wilson. Thank you.